GoToWebinar control panel. We had over 400 students register for the class. So welcome to the class, How to Inspect Plumbing Fixtures class. It's a free online live class that we do here at InterNACHI. My name is Ben Gromicko. I'm from InterNACHI. That's the International Association of Certified Home Inspectors. And we're headquartered in Boulder, Colorado. The door is always open. If you're ever in Colorado, it's really fun in the summertime to go rafting and to climb mountains, if you're into that. Wintertime, go skiing and sled riding, if you're into that. So we're in Boulder, Colorado. We also have the House of Horrors built within our facility. And it's a house with 1,000 defects built under our roof. And it's for hands-on training purposes. This class is not hands-on. This is live, online, and free and open to everyone. And we do one or two of these every month. And to register for the next one, if you'd like to, or watch past recorded classes, because we record them all, go to this URL. It's natchi.org/class. And there you'll click a couple buttons to register or to watch a class. We even started doing podcasts. So we do podcasts about every week or two. And the last podcast was really good. I really enjoyed that. NACHI.org/contact is where the entire InterNACHI staff is. We're spread about the country a little bit. We have an office in New Mexico and Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, and headquartered in Boulder, Colorado. But everyone on staff is on NACHI.org/contact. If you need to contact me, go there. If you call anybody or email anybody, I'm probably within arm's reach of everyone at the headquarters. So feel free. And it's actually a membership benefit, really. The staff here at InterNACHI works for you. So if you're a member of InterNACHI and you need something for your business to be successful, feel free to contact us, especially if you can't find something. If you're interested in becoming a plumbing inspector, an InterNACHI certified plumbing inspector, we have a certificate program. It's free and online for members. And it's at natchi.org/certification. Let's go there now, real quick. And I'll show you what it looks like. We have more than 30 different types of certifications, not just InterNACHI Certified Home Inspector, but we have other ones. So all of these are online free certifications for our members. And here's the plumbing one. So plumbing inspector certification. You go there. It's basically three easy steps. One, you join InterNACHI. A whole world of opportunity opens up when you join InterNACHI because you have access to our online training, free online access. And then there's InterNACHI certification requirements. And then you take the plumbing course for inspectors and you get this nice logo. All right, so that's how you become an InterNACHI certified home inspector. Let's go back to there. Two things that we'll maybe look at after the class, but I want to give it to you right now. It's natchi.org/articles. That's where our library of inspection articles is located. And within that library, there's a really great article called, Did You Damage Something During Your Inspection? And what happens and how you should handle that. And that's the direct link right here to that article. But let's go back. We're here to learn about how to inspect plumbing fixtures. So if I go to the plumbing, certified plumbing inspector certification, number three is the class that we're going to use today. It's an online class called Residential Plumbing Overview for Inspectors course. It's an online course, free and online to our members. And we're actually going to today look at chapter four or section four of the online course. And we're going to learn about fixtures, access, connections, flanges and joints, tailpieces, temperature controls, overflows, clearances for the water closet, what's on the side, what's in the front, urinals, bidets, not too many bidets in the United States, lavatories and wash basins, sinks, what's the difference between those three, food waste grinders, garbage disposals, dishwashing machines, what's that high loop all about? Bathtubs, whirlpool tubs, showers, glazing, automatic clothes washer, laundry tubs and trays, floor and trench drains, and water supply. And then we'll take a quiz if you're still with us. Shall we start? Looks good? Oh, yes? All right. Cool, let's go. So, general comments. The surfaces of all the plumbing fixtures and faucets should be smooth, and there shouldn't be any defects with them. Typically, they are installed and built to conform with certain standards and installation standards and manufacturer's recommendations. We are not code inspectors. This is not a code inspection course. This is not a code inspection class. What we use code for is to help us determine whether something is right or wrong, safe or unsafe, defect or not. Right? It just helps us. So we, in some states, you can't say the word code. So we say like building practices or standards or best practices. But just so you know, InterNACHI's online training courses and live classes, they're all based upon international codes. Codes are really designed, think of it, to keep people safe. When a firefighter gets injured, let's say, the fire code probably gets changed in the next cycle, right? To keep people safe and to keep things functioning well. Refer to the codes as a standard by which you can almost base your opinions on, right? But as a certified home inspector, you're basically providing your opinion. So feel free to move within that work scope. You're not a code inspector. So with that in mind, let's take a look at the number of plumbing fixtures. What should be in a home? In general, for a home, each home should have at least one water closet or toilet. So if you're doing a home and you know it's vacant, it's being renewed, maybe it's being flipped, and the toilet's missing, you're obviously gonna comment upon that. But here's why you should comment upon it, because every home is actually required to have at least one water closet. It's called a water closet. We'll learn why it's called a water closet, why it's called a water closet. It's a toilet. One lavatory, which is really the bath sink, one bathtub or shower, a kitchen sink, and one automatic clothes washer connection. The washing machine doesn't have to be installed by code, but typically it is. And if it's missing, I'm certainly going to point it out as a concern. For an apartment house, the clothes washer connection is ratio is 1:20. So you need one clothes washer connection for every 20 apartment units. Plumbing fixtures should be installed so as to provide access for cleaning, obviously. One time in the basement of a home that was finished by a homeowner kind of quickly, the laundry tub area was actually concealed behind a finished wall. Nuts. Couldn't even access it. There was a fixture behind a wall, right? I tried to find it for this class. I couldn't find it. I still remember it. But every fixture should be able to be accessed and should be cleaned. There must not be any concealed spaces that do not facilitate proper cleaning. Plumbing connections with slip joints should have access provided for inspection and repair. What's a slip joint? So what's a slip? What's a common slip joint? What's the most common probably slip joint that you look at as a home inspector almost every day? Anybody have an answer? You guys still there? Most common slip joint? Anyone? You want to type it in? All right, I'll give it to you. The P-trap underneath the kitchen sink, right? Yeah, very good, Nick. All right, Brian. All right, James. Yep, so that's a slip joint. Again, technical code definition, slip joint. It's really that P-trap. That's a good common slip joint. You should have access to that. The access panel or utility space should be at least 12 inches in its smallest dimension. You gotta get your arm in there or your face in there, at least. If it's really far away, you should probably have like 18 inches of a access dimension. Plumbing fixtures, drains, appurtenances, appliances used for liquid waste and sewage, right? Gotta be connected directly to the sewer line. You can't have a lavatory sink, bathroom sink down in the basement, dumping into the sump pump. Why? Because that's a code violation, shh. But it's really not the best practice, right? There could be a lot of things going on wrong with that. odors and bacteria. It's not clean. It's not reliable. It's not properly installed. According to what? My opinion? No. Actually, in the back end, yeah, I have an opinion, but that opinion is based upon plumbing code, right? A floor flange should be used in the connection between the drain and the floor outlet plumbing fixture. Well, toilet just comes to mind, right? The flange should be securely attached to the drain and anchored to the structure. Now, a urinal is mounted to the wall, and that should be mounted really well, not weighted on the flange or on any of the piping of the urinal. Not many urinals in residential homes. But the most commonly used setting compound is a wax ring made out of beeswax or synthetic wax. If you've ever installed, replaced, or installed a toilet, you know what that wax ring is. It's a mess once you screw it up. If you put it down right, if you install it right, it is a really nice seal. Once that toilet is removed, really, a new wax seal should be put down. Once the toilet is moved or shifted, that could be a problem too, because that wax seal has no memory, so it doesn't pop back. What's this have to do with home inspections? Well, I used the side of my leg at the side of the toilet and water closet, and I used my leg just slightly to see if the toilet is loose on the floor, if it's loosely connected to the flange. Closet bolts, water closet bolts, toilet bolts, are usually made of brass because of its strength and corrosion resistance, and they alone hold the closet to the flange. And the flange receives the closet bolts, so those two are connected. And then the flange itself is connected to the floor structure, right? So that's how it's all connected. The flange firmly holds the closet to the structure without putting any load on the drainage pipe that's attached to the flange. So here's a little toilet here. There's my foot. I'm flushing it, and I give a little push. I also, when I put my side of my leg up against the side of the water closet toilet to see if it moves or turns or is loose, I'm also testing the floor structure around the toilet as well. Because if that wax seal that we talked about leaks and the bottom of the toilet is sealed completely, then there's water held in there for a long time and it could be leaking and no one knows it. I used to install toilets, right, home builder, and I used to leave about 3 inches of unsealed space around the bottom of the toilet so that if there is leak, it would actually come out onto the floor and near the water bolt. I think that's the best practice, though. It's not really code. Fixture tailpieces. So what's a tailpiece? A tailpiece is that thing that's attached to the underside, let's say, of the kitchen sink or laundry tub, right? It's that cylindrical piece of pipe, right, that goes into like a slip joint, is inserted, it slips into the joint of the P-trap, right? So that's the tailpiece. And here it is here. This is a InterNACHI illustrated thing. Slip joint goes in there. Trap adapter. Here's the trap weir right there. This is the water line where the water drains down at a slope. And this is the trap itself. Typically, it doesn't have a clean out, but some do. Like commercial, for sure, has clean outs. And old traps have clean outs. And there are some restrictions. This can't be too tall. The tailpiece can't be too long. And this can't be horizontally more than 30 inches away from things. So just in general, it should look like that. It shouldn't look like an S. That's a P-trap. It looks like a P. If you turn to the side, right? Looks like a P. So that's a P-trap. Tailpieces are short lengths of pipe attached directly to a fixture by means of a flange for connection to other piping or traps. Tailpieces should be at least one and one half inches in diameter for sinks, dishwashers, laundry tubs, bathtubs, and similar fixtures, which is consistent with the minimum size for fixture drains, traps, trap arms. So that's a tailpiece, a P-trap. There's the P-trap there coming up, slip joint, tailpiece, connection to the bottom of a plastic laundry tub that's attached, wall-mounted, cold, hot. Tail pieces should be at least 1 1/4 inches in diameter for bidets and lavatories and similar fixtures like lavatories. Some standards limit the maximum vertical length of a tailpiece between 24 and 36 inches. Here's a picture of a P-trap, soft brass, chrome coating. I love squeezing these old soft brass P-traps. That was so much fun. I no longer do inspections. But when I was doing inspections, I loved grabbing those and breaking those. It's good if I broke one of those because I know that it's going to break when my client moves in. So P-traps should not break. Not break when you bump them with a can underneath the sink in the cabinet or some storage there, a bucket. They should be strong to the touch, but if they easily crush, that means that was deteriorating. Good thing you caught it before your client moves in. What's wrong with this picture? It's the gasket, really, and the indications of watermarks. So the rubber gasket, the black rubber gasket, where the flange connection is attached to the bottom of this fixture, lavatory, bathroom sink. The flange is old, cracked, deteriorated, not flexible anymore. It's leaking water. There are water marks around this area. There's actually rust developing on the ring. So I would call that out as a problem. Any questions? Are we doing good? How do we view the chat window? The chat window has got to be down at the bottom right corner. On my control panel, it says chat. And there's a little, twirl down kind of arrow. So hopefully you can get into that. All right, no major, Victoria got it now. Thanks. Good, Victoria. No major questions so far. Okay, so consumption and distribution flow rates. Like you have a fixture, how much water does it consume? And how much water does it discharge, right, give? So I would say that one of the most important things for the water closet, which is your toilet, is this number, 1.6 gallons per flushing cycle. That's the kind of like the new standard, and that's the normal standard now. Some highly efficient toilets do like 1.28 gallons per flush. I haven't really come across many of those. I heard they're out there. I kind of like the pressurized tanks now. And for the supply outlets, we used to run a lot of water for testing the water and the water flow. So at the bathtub, you can expect 4 gallons per minute. The toilet, the water closet should be filling up quickly at about 5-6 gallons a minute under certain pressures. The seal caulk or hose bib water spigot on the outside. A lot of folks put a pressure tester there, a meter gauge, a water flow gauge, and use that to discharge water and test the water flow. You can expect about 5 or more gallons per minute out of that. A sink is very slow, 1 or 2 gallons a minute. Laundry tub, laundry tray, they call it, about 4 or 5 gallons. That's a good way to run some water if you wanted to run some water. So just know, to have a good idea of the amount of water a particular fixture consumes. Toilets are the most common, 1.6, right, if somebody asks you. And then when you're thinking about a flow rate, how much water comes out of this fixture, probably the seal caulk, the outside water spigot, has a lot of flow. And that would be where I would test. If I needed to run water, I usually go outside and run that water, especially if it's on a septic system, because that water can then just be discharged into the yard or the grass, ideally. Hot is on the left when you're looking at the fixture outlet itself. Fixtures that have both hot and cold water supplied to them must be installed and adjusted so that the left-hand side of the water temperature control represents the hot water when facing the fixture outlet. The exception could be where you have a fixture and there's a marking on it, some almost like commercial, like when you're in a hotel, not necessarily the hot's gonna be on the left, it could be like a turning, it'll be marked, right? Temperature control A temperature control valve protects against rapid temperature fluctuations by a few degrees Fahrenheit. Every shower and combination tub shower must have a control valve that is capable of protecting an individual from being scalded while taking a shower. Such control valve must be installed at the point of use. The thermostat at the hot water tank, hot water source, is not considered the control valve to protect people from being scalded. To prevent an accidental scald, a maximum set point feature is required for the valves. A water temperature limiting device can be adjusted to prevent the water temperature from rising to 110 degrees. A shower and tub shower valves must be equipped with control valves of the pressure balance, thermostatic mixing, or combination of those two types, with a high limit stop. The high limit stop must limit the water temperature to a maximum of 120 degrees. Here's a little burn chart. So you could tell your clients why you're so concerned with the water temperature. Many home inspectors will use a laser thermometer, a little probe thermometer, and test the water from a fixture. It's great. At 100 degrees, just about everything is safe for an adult and for a child. When it gets to 120 degrees, for an adult, it's a few minutes before you get burns. For a kid, it's about 2.5 minutes, or 2 minutes really, for a child to become scalded with third degree burns at 120 degrees, 120. So in certain climates, northern cold climates, I inspected in Pennsylvania, that's a north cold climate in the United States, we had oil boilers that heated water to really high temperatures, 180 degrees. And that hot water had a coil, there was a coil there, and domestic potable water would go through that area of the boiler and get heated really hot and come out scalding, 160, 170, 180 degrees, and would sometimes just go directly to the fixtures of the home, right? So that was a hazard. You need a temperature control valve to temper that water down, and at the point of use, right, for especially tubs, showers, and combinations. And there's a sauna standard. It's set at 194 degrees. And the thermostat, if it's not integrated with the heater, the sensing element should be located near the ceiling of the sauna control, of the sauna itself. Let's go to overflows, right? What's an overflow? An overflow is that little hole in the sink when water fills up and you're not watching it during an inspection, thank goodness the water goes down, right? So it's designed to prevent fixtures from flooding or overflowing into the area when the watertight stopper is closed or the drain is clogged. A stopper must not interfere with the overflow opening or water overflowing from the fixture. Bathtubs and lavatories, bath sinks, can have overflows installed. These two fixtures are often used without close observation. So a person preparing to take a bath will typically turn on the tub water and leave while the tub's filling up. If left for a long time, the water may rise to a height where overflow will take that excess water down. But many tubs are capable of supplying water. Remember we saw that table of tubs supplying water? At a rate greater than the flow of the overflow. So with such fixtures, overflowing and flooding may not be prevented. Bathtubs must be equipped with both waste outlet and an overflow outlet. Outlets must be connected to a waste drain pipe of at least 1.5 inches in diameter. What's wrong with this picture? Well, it's a picture of I wanted to see if someone's answering. Yep. Is there a simple gauge or device for testing gallons per minute for more exact flow rate? Oh yeah, you can get it online. You can just Google it. It's a pressure, PSI, and flow rate gauge. You'll have two gauges, an in and an out, and a valve or two handles or one handle. And that's what I used. I was in a state, Pennsylvania, that didn't require you to measure that, but again, in Texas and other states, you have to measure flow and pressure. And some home inspectors just do this out of courtesy. In this inspection image of a steel bathroom sink, the overflow is corroded and leaking water. In some areas that have adopted certain modern codes, overflows at bathroom sinks are actually not required. Inlet side. An overflow discharges on the inlet side of the fixture or the water trap. So here you could see the overflow of the sink from underneath is this part, and it comes down and it goes into the drain before the trap. This is to prevent sewer gases from coming out of the overflow, right? It's upstream of the water trap, right? The overflow drains into the fixture. Just a little thing that's on the inlet side. The exception actually could be a simple flush tank where you look in the inside of the tank and you've got that overflow tube coming up. That overflow tube actually collects overflow, but it drains right into the toilet fixture itself where there's some sewer odor gases. That's just an exception. And here's a picture of me doing an inspection, running water at the bathroom sink. I'm doing a shower, GFCIs, looking for the GFCI reset, and I come back up and it is a clogged drain, and thank goodness for the overflow, right? But watch. Not all sinks that you may think have an overflow will have one, right? And we'll talk about that a little bit later. Clearances for the toilet. It's 15 inches, right? So it's 15 inches of space from the center of the toilet. Go in the center. That's not much space, actually. So really, it's like kind of tight, right? 30 inches wide, essentially, from the middle of the toilet. 15 inches this way, 15 inches that way. So there should be at least 30 inches of space between adjacent fixtures. So if you have two bathroom fixtures really close to each other, that's kind of silly. There should be at least 30 inches. And there should be a space of at least 21 inches in front of the toilet, lavatory, or bidet to any other wall, any fixture or other wall part or door. And this clearance is just for comfort. So in this picture, in this inspection picture, is there adequate clearance or inadequate clearance on the sides of the toilet? There is adequate clearance, right? There's at least 4 feet there of space, right? There's probably 2 feet from the center of the toilet, left and right. However, some inspections, like you open the bathroom door, maybe for the half bath in the first floor, and it bounces right into the toilet. Now, when the door is closed, there's plenty of clearance, but when the door is in operation, it hits the toilet. Well, there's this little sentence in code. It's like an approach to that problem in a different way. The location of the water pipes, fixtures, or equipment must not interfere with the operation of the doors and windows. So the door was interfered, the door operation was interfered with this toilet that the door hit the toilet as it was opened. Because when the door is closed, there's plenty of room, but the door operation was interfered with. So a water closet, what's a water closet? In the United States, water closet is commonly referred to as a toilet. The term water closet originates from a time when plumbing was brought indoors and defecation took place in actually a closet, a little small little area with a pot. So you got your bedroom pot in the middle of the night and you went into the closet and you did your business. And there are 3 common styles of water closets, really. Maybe 6, but I just coupled them a little bit. One is the closed coupled one, the most common one. There's the one piece, and then there's some kind of flush-o-meter valve. And the most common one is the closed coupled water closet, which has a bowl that you sit on and a tank. They're separated, but then they're bolted and sealed together. The one piece water closet, in my experience, they never did very well. But it's just one integrated unit where the tank and the water storage and the bowl is all one piece. And then there's one with a flush-o-meter valve, water closet. It's a bowl with a flush-o-meter valve. And water closet bowls come in 6 styles. The blowout, the siphon jet, the reverse trap, washdown, siphon vortex, and siphon wash. And you probably don't need to know all that during an inspection. But there are just many various types of toilets out there. And there are 3 types of devices that are required to flush a water closet or urinal. There's the flush tank, obviously, the flush-o-meter valve, and the flush-o-meter tank. The flush tank works with gravity, using only the pressure of the water in the tank. It's a very common kind of tank. That's what we probably inspect in the United States. Everything else has, you know, it's that one where you push the handle down and it goes. They actually perform really well. The water closet measurements. You want one high enough, right, to sit on. And the average is about 15 inches high, 15 inches high. Kids, they can have their own toilets at about 10 inches high. People with physical disabilities or elderly, they want a higher one, maybe 18 inches high. And then there are elongated toilets where it's actually elongated another couple inches in the front. And the maximum flush consumption is 1.6 gallons per water flush cycle. And it's connected, that fixture, that water closet, it's connected to the drainage. A 4-inch by 3-inch water closet bend should be allowed, and it's not actually considered a reduction. So you have this 4-inch hole, and then a flange goes down to 3 inches, but it's not actually technically considered right there as a reduction. Anywhere else, if you see a 4-inch to a 3-inch, like in the basement ceiling, you see the drain waste vent pipe, the drain pipe to the sewer pipe, right, to the street, and it's reduced, that's a defect, that's a problem. You can't reduce it. Just in this water closet area where the flange is. Defects at the water closet. Well, the water closet, toilet, could have a clogged drain. That's why we flush them. I flush them twice at least, because I want to hear it fill up again. While flushing the toilet, watch the flush performance. Some inspectors put about 4 feet of toilet paper in the toilet and flush it, and it'll just like sucking on a spaghetti noodle, right? It should suck it right in. There shouldn't be excessive odors around the water closet. Check the flooring around the toilet with your foot. Use the side of your leg to check to see if it's securely attached to the floor or the wax ring is messed up. Look for dampness around the bottom of the toilet base. Toilets sometimes run continuously. Check for, and it's not okay to just shake the handle. It really needs to stop. We need to stop wasting water at our toilets. Check for a water shutoff valve, and some toilets are mistakenly connected to the hot water tank system. That sentence is in there in our course because I actually did that. So I plumbed up a toilet. It was a second floor toilet, and somehow I got confused between the rough-in pipes, and I plumbed in the hot water to the toilet tank. And for a couple moments there, I thought, this is a good idea, I'm gonna leave it. But then I realized that's a waste. So it's not connected to this fixture is not connected to the hot water supply system. What fixture that we're going to get to in this class, what fixture is connected to the hot water supply system? It's kind of like the most common fixture that you would think. What is connected directly to what fixture in the house is directly connected to the hot water supply? Do you know? Yes, Lori, got it. You win. I don't have anything to give you. it's the dishwasher, right? So what's wrong with this inspection image? What's my concern here? This is my picture that I took. Well, let's start off with the components, right? This is a bolt, right? And the bolt is connected to the flange. The flange is connected to the floor, and the flange is also connected without any weight or stress to the drain pipe. What kind of bolt is that? It's brass, right? And it's missing a nut, right? It has a washer there. I don't know what was going on. It's also missing a cap. You can cut this. Some have a little indentations. You can crack it off and put a nice white cap on it. No big deal that the cap is missing. Some of these are over-tightened, and then it presses down on this part, I'm not gonna say flange, wing of the toilet base, and cracks it. And then my other concern is these watermarks around the base of the toilet, right? It's not urine, it's water. And I don't know, it's from cleaning, there's a leak, I'm trying to flush it as many times. There's only so much a home inspector can do during an inspection. It's time sensitive. Restricted. So any indications of watermarks around the toilet, I'm going to comment on it. If it's wet, I'm going to comment on it for sure. I wear gloves when I actually do the interior inspection of the entire house, especially for bathroom fixtures and basements and other places that are not all that clean. And then moisture meters. Let's see if I have one. Yeah, so here's a comment. Oh, look at that. So here's, somebody asked about, here's my valve that I use. One side is pressure, one side is gallons per minute. In, there's a screen there, and out. And that's what I use. This is a pretty common tool. I carry that around for every inspection. Here's a temperature gauge to probe the sink water. I usually do the sink water or the tub, you know. So I check the water temperature for this. I keep forgetting I have tools on my tool shelf. And here's a protometer. Non-invasive, audible sounds, quantitative also, and pins too. So you can put this up against, on a tile floor around the toilet, a vinyl sheathing around the toilet. It'll tell you if there's something going on that you can't actually see or feel with your hand. So I use those devices. I really got into devices when I was doing a home inspection because it just made my work a lot easier, especially using infrared as well. Infrared helps for seeing watermarks on certain, it should be like a vinyl floor or a tile floor, but if it's carpeting, that really pops out. So that's the inspection defect there. Urinals. I don't think I've ever seen a urinal, probably in a basement. Some basements will have a urinal, but not typically in the United States. Urinal is a fixture. It's been designed for urination, not defecation. And there are basically four types of water supplied urinals. Stall, siphon jet, washdown, and blowout. And the consumption is about only a gallon per flush. But waterless urinals are becoming popular, right? Because they're considered a sustainable, a green method for handling urine. Wall and floor space is interesting. Must be waterproofed. And it's about 2 feet in front, 4 feet above the floor, and 2 feet on the sides. I guess men can't hit the target, so we gotta have everything waterproofed around the urinals. And it should be cleanable and non-absorbent. Bidets, not very common. Came across a few. Some of the very fancy homes have bidets. It's a small, actually, bathing fixture. It's like a bathtub, used by both sexes. It's not designed for defecation, getting human waste out, but it's for cleaning your body parts and even your feet. There's typically one or two water sprays at the bottom of the bidet bowl. And most bidets present a back siphoning problem because the spray nozzle is located below the flood level rim of the fixture. What is the flood level rim of a fixture? Think of a sink, laundry tub sink. You know, it's kind of square, it's got that rim around it, right? And that's the flood level. That's where the level where a flood starts to happen, when it starts to overflow, if you don't have an overflow fixture, right, at the fixture, at the sink. Overflow feature. So that's the flood level rim. And we can actually measure that to see how big a sink is. We measure the rim size, like the rim of a car wheel. So the spray nozzle is below that. So there can be some back siphoning. And water supplied to a bidet should have a protection against backflow. And the temperature of the discharging water from a bidet should be limited to a maximum of 110 degrees because you don't want, you want to protect yourself and your parts there. So a lavatory, what's a lavatory? Not laboratory where there's rats and technicians. Lavatory, L-A-V, is a wash basin or sink located in a bathroom or a washroom. Lavatory means wash basin or sink. And it's derived from the Latin word lavatorium, or the French word laver, meaning to wash. Lavatories come in a variety of shapes and sizes, available in many different materials. Cast iron is a good one, china, stainless steel, porcelain enameled, form steel. Those are the fun ones because they rust. Plastic, not very reliable. They deteriorate. And ceramic, they crack. They could be wall mounted, hanger mounted, under mounted, pedestal, rimmed, and above center basin types. And there could be countertops that are integrated with it. If they're plastic, there's a fire rated chemical, fire resistant chemical, that helps reduce the fuel contribution of the lavatory during a house fire or an accidental fire from a plumber and his or her torch. They help with cigarettes. Lavatories should have a waste outlet of at least 1 1/4 inches in diameter. Every lav has a strainer and a pop-up stopper, a crossbar, or other mechanism to stop your wedding ring from falling down in, or your comb, or your toothbrush. Although that happens all the time. I've got 3 kids. Everything goes down the sink. Lavatory overflows. Now, in the past, the standard required lavatories, bathroom sinks, the standard required them to have an overflow. And that's technically no longer the standard in many adopted plumbing codes. The overflow is now an option for the manufacturer. The reason for not requiring an overflow at a lavatory is because of the lack of the use of the overflow, and that caused bacteria and microorganism growth. This is not a lavatory, but think of your kitchen sink, right? Your kitchen sink is a fixture, and it doesn't have an overflow device. There's not one installed, right, in the United States, kitchen sinks. Where a lavatory does have an overflow installed, the cross-sectional area needs to be big enough. So there's a minimum cross-sectional area of 1 1/8 inch. And this minimum prevents the overflow from being too small. So it should be able to take some of the water away. And lavatory rim, we went over that. You get the sink, the rim is the overflow area, right? 20 inches is typically good for one fixture. If it's bigger, greater than 20 inches, it's called a group wash up fixture. Let's go to sinks, yes? Checking, water heater leak, seal leak, my connection is very not good right now. Log off, sorry, that's okay, Juan. If you log back on, sometimes you can get in at a better connection. Sinks are plumbing fixtures, which include kitchen sinks, service sinks, the sink at the bar, mop sinks, wash sinks. A sink is considered a different item than a lavatory or a bathroom sink, although the terms are often used interchangeably. Sinks can be made of cast iron, steel, those are fun, plastic materials, same thing as the bathroom sinks. And the sink waste outlet should have a minimum diameter of a little bit bigger, 1 1/2 inches. Most kitchen sinks have an opening of 3 1/2 inches in diameter at the top. So here's a garbage disposal, food waste grinder. Here's a kitchen sink bottom. Here's the 3 1/2 inches there, nice gasket. P-trap, tailpiece, a slip joint. Cold water supply to the sink, hot water supply and valve to the sink. At here, you can't see it, but there's another T off of this valve probably, and it goes to is hot water going to the dishwasher. And it goes behind the garbage disposal, and there's the braided mesh hose going to the dishwasher. Discharge hose from the dishwasher, high up loop coming from the loop attached or fastened high up underneath the countertop. And it goes connected, its nipple is in the garbage disposal, right? And it drains in there. That's where it drains. It could drain into a Y fitting underneath the kitchen sink as well. So this one has a garbage disposal, and most garbage disposals now have that little nipple, and you put it in there. Take the plastic cap off, and there you go. Food waste grinder, I just call it a garbage disposal, has a standard opening of 3.5 inches at the top, and so do most kitchen sink basket strainers. A strainer or a crossbar should be provided to restrict the clear opening of a waste outlet. For a garbage disposal, you can stick your hand right in there. In this inspection image here, there is a problem that I have. It is actually at the fixture faucet stem and connection to the sink itself. It's been coated with a lot of clear silicone. It's just leaking. Not sure what's wrong. Doesn't matter. It's leaking water when I turn on water, and that's a defect. I'll call that out. So again, here's the tailpiece, slip joint, water trap, and there's the trap arm. P-trap versus S-trap. Very easy. A P-trap looks like a P. An S-trap looks like an S. So S-trap on the left, P-trap on the right. And you shouldn't have any S-traps. I used to do a lot of inspections in 30-year-old homes, and S-traps were so common, very common. So I guess the problem with the trap is the S-trap has some siphoning problems. It'll gurgle and siphon out the water trap. And the trap is no longer a trap. So S-traps are not permitted anymore. Has to be a P-trap. To explain this, we actually have this illustration in the InterNACHI inspection gallery for inspectors. You can grab an image. It can be high res. It could be low res. You can stick it in your report. And it's really cool. All the illustrations, thousands of them, are free to our members. Food waste grinders, garbage disposal, are designed to grind food, including bones, into small bits that can flow through the drain line. But my kids love to throw in stringy food, like corn husks or celery or banana skins. And it's not recommended because those fibers tend to pass by the grinder teeth and move into the drain and cause clogs. Water is supplied to the grinder to assist in its operation. The water flushes the grinder chamber and carries the waste down the drain pipe. Blockage may result if the grinder is used without running water during their operation. Grinders should be connected to a drain of 1.5 inches in diameter, no less than that. Food waste grinders are supplied with water from the sink faucet. They don't add. There isn't any, so remember that discharge pipe from the dishwasher? Had an inspector, he thought it was water being supplied to the food waste grinder. It's not, there's no water supply connected to a food waste grinder in a residential home. There's no water supply to it. So they use the water coming from the fixture faucet in the kitchen. Dishwashing machines. When I was an inspector, I turned them on just as courtesy, took a look inside, open and closed, did a short cycle, see if it leaked. If it didn't, great. Took a look at the door and things like that, small components. In some states, you're required to inspect the dishwasher, like in Texas, with detail, and we're going to go over some details here. Water supplied to a dishwashing machine should be protected against backflow by an air gap. What does that mean, by an air gap? An air gap, think of a laundry tub sink and the fixture comes out like this, and there's a gap in the air. There's a space, there's an airspace, a space with nothing connected to it above the flood rim level. We talked about what that is, right? So this water here in the tub can't get back into and siphon in. Unlike a bidet, remember? The spray nozzle is in the bottom of the basin, of the bowl. And water can get in and siphon back in and backflow into the potable water supply. And that's nasty, right? So there's a feature that prevents that. So in the dishwasher, where's the air gap in the dishwasher? It's inside. So a little water comes out and it's there's an air gap in between there. Or there's a backflow preventer, or both. So the washing machine must be equipped with an integral backflow mechanism, or the potable water supply must have either a backflow preventer or an air gap. There is a standard, a plumbing standard, for residential and domestic type dishwashing machines where the requirement for protecting the potable water supply is there. against backflow. If the unit conforms to the standard, it's integrated in the device and nothing else needs to be done. So modern, new dishwashers have taken care of all that stuff. I don't know if you've ever installed a dishwasher. It comes from the manufacturer, all packaged up in a cube, ready to go. The hoses are there, water supply hoses, discharge tubes. It's pretty easy. The discharge hose from the dishwasher should be increased to a minimum of 3/4 inch in diameter. The discharge gets a little bit bigger. They want to discharge out. And it should be connected with a Y fitting to the sink tailpipe or to the food waste grinder. The Y fitting, I don't have a picture. If this is the tail piece from the connected to the underside of the kitchen sink, and this goes to a P-trap, imagine that. The Y fitting will look like this, right? Let's see if I can get it. There, it'll look like that. It's a Y fitting. And the discharge of the dishwasher, the hose, will go like that and connect in to like that, okay? So that's what that means. Or the discharge of the hose goes into the garbage disposal. Before connecting the sink tailpiece, the dishwasher waistline should rise and be securely fastened as high as possible to the underside of the countertop. You'll see that dishwasher waistline, typically like a white or gray plastic hose, and it's looped. It'll be looped already on the dishwasher, but manufacturers will recommend looping it again. We call it the high loop of the dishwasher tube, and it goes into the Y fitting or the food waste grinder, right? Or an air gap, and we'll talk about that. It should be fastened or held in place before connecting to the food waste grinder or to the Y fitting in the kitchen sink tailpiece. The combined discharge from a sink, dishwasher, and waste grinder is allowed to discharge through a single 1.5 inch trap. So there's a 3D illustration from InterNACHI Illustrators. Here is the cold water line, hot water line, and this goes to the sink, right? It goes up to the sink. And this one goes hot water line to the dishwasher fixture, gets hot water. And here's the discharge pipe. Go to the high loop, goes underneath the kitchen countertop, fastened high up, that's the high loop, and it goes into the garbage disposal in this illustration. Simple illustration. The high loop from the dishwasher is on the left side here. So that's what that is. I call it the high loop from the dishwasher. During a home inspection, you may notice that the dishwasher drain makes this loop underneath the countertop next to the sink. This is considered a minimum installation requirement on every dishwasher drain installation. It is required by many, if not every, dishwasher manufacturer, and the high loop is required by municipalities that have adopted plumbing code or standards that require that. Here's a dishwasher gap. This is a little bit different. It's not a high loop, it's kind of like a high loop, but there's an air gap there, and it connects into the Y fitting, really. An alternative or complementary component to the high loop is the air gap, and the air gap is a device that is actually mounted above the countertop surface. In your area, an air gap device may be required by the authority having jurisdiction. If an air gap device is not required, the dishwasher drain hose should have a high loop installed to prevent the backflow of water into the dishwasher and prevent water from siphoning out during the dishwasher operation. Here's a picture of a dishwasher to be installed. It actually comes with the hoses. On the back or on the side, you'll see a high loop. Right here, this high loop has a clip on the back. If your sink is to the right, it'll work. If your sink is to the left, you gotta unclip it and turn the hose and clip it back on again. There's the high loop. But that manufacturer recommends a second high loop to be installed underneath the kitchen sink. Inspection, new dishwashers are assembled by the manufacturer with a high drain loop already installed on the side of the dishwasher. However, most manufacturers still require another high loop installed on the discharge hose underneath the kitchen countertop at the dishwasher area. Here's a simple checklist for inspecting a dishwasher. It's kind of cool. This comes from Texas, actually. The inspector should report as a defect in need of correction a dishwasher that doesn't work in an operative unit, right? Rust on the interior of the cabinets or components. You shouldn't see any rust. Failure to drain properly, and the presence of active water leaks. Those are defects in need of correction. The inspector should report indications of problems in the following things: door gasket, control and control panels, any problems in the dish racks or rollers, the spray arms, operation of the soap dispenser. Ron Huffman, director of our school here at House of Horrors, InterNACHI, told me that he made sure that his inspectors considered the door operation of the soap door. So they closed the soap door, they ran a cycle, and they wanted to make sure that it was open. Some soap doors don't open anymore. The door springs, the dryer element, the door latch and door disconnect, the rinse cap, secure mounting of the unit. It has to be balanced and measured. They got to measure those things before they slide them in and secure them. It has to be level, but also has to have a little gap as well, and backflow prevention. Here are some sample report narratives. What do you say after you inspect the dishwasher fixture? The inspector may perform the inspection and write his or her findings based upon the following sample narratives. The dishwasher was operated through a normal cycle and appeared to be in serviceable condition at the time of the inspection. That's a pretty good sentence. The dishwasher lacks an anti-siphon device. The dishwasher did not appear to have an anti-siphon device installed on the drain line. Recommend further evaluation and correction by a qualified technician. The drain line was improperly installed. Dishwasher drain line was improperly configured and should be corrected by a qualified contractor. The dishwasher had a high loop installed at the time of the inspection. Dishwasher had an air gap device installed. Air gap is designed to prevent wastewater from contaminating the dishwasher. The dishwasher did not respond when controls were operated. Further evaluation and necessary repairs by a qualified technician is recommended. Dishwasher made unusual noise that it indicated was not operating properly. Further evaluation, repairs by a technician. Dishwasher installed was incomplete at the time of the inspection. Should be installed. Dishwasher leaked onto the floor. Evaluation and repair. Dishwasher was not operated. Dishwasher appeared to be old, did not appear to have been run recently, and it may leak. The inspector disclaims this operation of the dishwasher. The client should ask the seller about its condition. And then the home had no dishwasher installed at the time of the inspection. So some sample narratives of inspecting a dishwasher fixture. Bathtubs and whirlpool tubs are next. Bathtubs are made of many different types of materials. As you know, cast iron, porcelain, enameled, steel, plastic. Plastic tubs are made from materials such as ABS, PVC, fiberglass reinforced plastic, acrylic, marble acrylic. Bathtubs that are equipped with shower fixtures should be manufactured with slip-resistant surfaces. Bathtubs should have a drainage outlet, a tailpiece, with a minimum diameter of 1.5 inches. Every tub should be equipped with a watertight stopper. There should be an overflow installed at the bathtub. This prevents flooding if the tub is being filled while unattended. It also prevents overflowing when the tub is full and someone gets in. Hot water supplied to bathtubs and whirlpool tubs should not be greater than 120 degrees and be limited by a water temperature limiting device, except where that type of temperature protection is provided by a combination tub shower valve, and many inspectors will inspect the walls and tub bottom, including the tiles, the surfaces, sealant grout, and caulking. So here's some suggested inspection procedures for inspecting a bathtub. Inspectors may look for indications of defects with the water drainage, the water supply, by viewing the functional flow in two fixtures operated simultaneously. I like to turn on the tub and then inspect that, and then turn on the shower fixture, and then turn on a sink or two, or maybe even flush the toilet, to see what happens when a couple fixtures are turned on simultaneously in the same bathroom. The installation of hot and cold water faucets, the mechanical drain stops that are missing or did not operate at the tub, loose or loose sounding tiles at the tub and shower walls, The inspector may check for a plumbing access panel on the opposite side of the tub fixture. I called it out if I didn't have a plumbing access panel. I want to see that tailpiece. I want to see the water supply lines. I want to see the valves if they're installed right there. Inspectors may check the bottom corners of the tub and shower where the fixture meets the bathroom floor, looking for water damage or indications of water leaks. Inspectors may check the installation of the shower head, the tub faucet, and handles for functional performance or loose installation. I always just grabbed the shower a little bit, the shower head, and just wiggled it a little bit to see if it had the fixture with the drop ears securely fastened into the wall, right? If the shower has a tile base, the inspector may check the shower pan by stopping the drain and filling the shower. On older homes with tile showers, and there's tile on the floor, that's what I did. So I stopped it, had a little stopper, rubber thing. Some have magnets, you can put a magnet down, to stop the flow of water, run the shower. I like to run hot water. Things expand when the temperature is hot. And then I let it sit for a little bit, a few minutes, and see what happens, especially if that shower pan is on the second floor and I can go on the first floor and look up. So I kind of did that and found a few problems with them. It's like impossible though to know what's going on with the shower pan or the materials. You only have no idea what it's even made out of. But it's possible to get one to fail if it has indications of failure. But it's like impossible to find. You really have to test it well. And that's way beyond the scope of a home inspection to test the shower pan. The inspector may check for safety glass to be installed where required, for sure. If the bathtub is jetted, the inspector may check if the jets function and if the jetted motor is GFCI protected and if it has access to that motor. So this is me, actually, a picture of me. And I like to pound on the tiles and take a picture of what I do, too. I like to listen to the backing of those tiles. And I also like to push a little bit with my thumb on the tiles around the fixture, the handles, the faucet, things like that. Loose tiles, they'll feel soft and they'll sound different. What's wrong here? Well, there's just a few things that look great. Like, oh, a beautiful tile, water's running, wonderful tile all over the place on the side and all that. But actually, all these tiles are loose. There's a ton of grout repair. It's poorly done. White sealant is being used instead of grout. And the tiles are loose, and there are watermarks on top of the tile and on the floor. And the floor tile sounds a little hollow, too. So there's some problems there. This is a plumbing access panel. This is what I like to see. The problem with this one is, well, the handle is missing on the hot water line. And there's a cracked tile near the base of this fixture, this tub, and just pounding my knuckles on it, I can hear a difference between that part of the tile and the part of the tile that's securely attached to the floor. Bathtubs are made out of plastic are tested for fire ignition. They're made it with fire-resistant chemicals, as we said before. Large bathtubs have big loads. And as a home inspector, you don't know how the floor structure actually is built. It's not part of your structural integrity, is not part of the scope of a home inspector, right? But just so you have this in mind, some bathtubs are so large, they can accommodate more than one person at a time. And these larger bathtubs may need special attention and additional structural support underneath them to adequately support the load. Here's an example. A 3x4 foot bathtub may have a holding capacity of 200 gallons. The weight of the bathtub, the water, and the occupants may total over 1 ton. So if you add them all up, 200 pounds for the bathtub, 1,600 pounds of water, 350 pounds for two people, that's over 2,000 pounds. So a very large tub may have some structural issues, because live loading for a typical residential home is 40 pounds per square foot. The live load for a 3x4 occupied tub may be assumed to be only 480 pounds, but it will actually weigh over a ton. So it's something to consider. again, as a home inspector, you're not into that. You don't have to do any of the math like that or report on the structural integrity. Whirlpool bathtub fixtures must be installed according to the manufacturer's recommendations, for sure. The bathtub may be filled with water and tested during the rough-in plumbing inspection, but oftentimes they were not. I still remember the time that I destroyed my computer with water because I filled up the master bathroom Whirlpool tub. It worked well. I drained it. I walked down to the kitchen and water started coming out of the ceiling and dropping down onto my computer and printer and just destroyed everything. So no one actually filled up that tub and drained it. So it's funny. And the homeowners never used the tub. So for years, that tub just sat ready for me to find. the pump of the Whirlpool tub must be located above the trap weir. Do you remember that illustration of what the trap weir is? You should know what that is. So that the pump drains each time that the tub is drained. And the piping should be all sloped to drain. Because you don't want any standing water in the pump, in the pipes, in the tub. Everything should be draining out. And there should be access. The minimum is 12 by 12 to get to the motor. If it's beyond like your reach, over 2 feet, you need more access. So 18 by 18 inches minimum sized opening should be installed. And here's some recommended procedures for inspecting a Whirlpool tub. Fully open the hot and cold water valves, faucets, and fill the tub up with at least 1 or 2 inches with water with at least 1 or 2 inches above the Whirlpool jets. Don't turn on the jets if that's not submersed by water. You want water over the jets. And it's not just over, it's 1, 2, 3 inches over. Because when you turn on the jets and they're just under the water surface, they're gonna shoot up and it's gonna get everything wet if they're shooting up. So I put my thumb in to the jets and I make sure all the jets are down. I fill up the tub, submerge the jets, and then I kick it on. Don't operate the pump until all the jets are submerged. Direct the jets downwards before activating the pump. Inspect the amount of bubbling with the controls. I haven't found a bubble standard yet. the suction inlets typically have very small openings, and that's because someone got their hair sucked in and they died. So there's a safety issue with the small, the inlets shouldn't be large openings in the tub. If dirty water comes out of the jets, the circulation system is probably dirty and the tub is not sanitary, and the inspector should recommend professional cleaning. That happens a lot, often, especially when the tub is not used often. There should not be any odor coming from the tub. All Whirlpool tubs have a dedicated electric circuit protected by a GFCI, so you can inspect and measure the area of that access panel as well to get to that motor and possibly wiring and plumbing and GFCI. Let's go to showers next. Showers are made out of everything. Acrylic, fiberglass, PVC, ABS, marble, acrylic. And these showers, again, the plastic ones, are impregnated with fire-resistant chemicals. The shower height is not typically regulated by most building codes, but the head is commonly installed at about 70 to 80 inches above the shower floor. Shower water pipes. Here's a water pipe for a shower. It's on the outside of the wall. Water supply pipes from the shower valve to the shower head outlet, referred to as the shower riser pipes, whether they're exposed, like those pictures, or embedded in the wall, must be firmly attached to a structural component to prevent the pipes from leaking caused by stress, fractures, or joint failures. Movement of the shower head may move the riser piping, possibly causing failure of the piping. That's why I grabbed that little pipe of the shower head just to see if it was installed. If it goes back and forth, something was missing. A strap is missing, or the drop ear elbow was not installed. And you can Google drop ear elbow. It's the elbow of the pipe, supply pipe. It looks like a little 90 degree, and it has these ears on the side where you screw two fasteners into something so that it's structurally supported, the shower head. The most common practice for installing the riser pipe is to place a drop ear elbow at the top of the riser pipe. That elbow has two wing connections and they can be screwed to a structural backing board such as 2x4, and a pipe strap can be used instead of the elbow. And when the riser is exposed, the manufacturer will provide a strap or attachment device to the finished surface. Shower outlets, 1.5 inches diameter. The outlet should have a strainer at least 3 inches in diameter with dimensional openings in the strainer of at least 1/4 inch. So you get these little holes, 1/4 inch in the strainer. The strainer should be removable. You'll typically see a screw. And in gang or multiple showers, the shower room floor should be sloped to the drain. The shower area is described in building codes. It should be big enough for a human being to get into and move around. The cross-sectional area of at least 900 square inches. It's hard to measure that, but you'll get a feel of it. Shower compartments should be at least 30 inches in minimum dimension. This measurement is based upon the movement of an adult body inside a shower, and this is measured from the finished interior dimension of the compartment without measuring the fixture valves, shower heads, dishes, grab bar, soap dishes, the shelves, and the grab bars. And there are exceptions for showers having fold-down seats. Shower walls should be finished with a non-absorbent surface that will extend to a height of not less than 6 feet above the floor level of the room or 70 inches above the shower floor. So if you have drywall at your chest level, that's not good for a shower, right? It needs to be high. 70 inches above the shower floor. That's like 6 feet, almost 6 feet. And it can be constructed of something smooth, corrosion and resistant, non-absorbent material to protect the structural components from moisture damage. You see a lot of tile installed in bathrooms and bathtubs and showers. The gypsum or cement board behind the tile should be water resistant. And water-resistant materials are not typically required in the rest of the bathroom, although it's common practice to use water-resistant gypsum board in other areas of the bathroom because of the moisture levels. Shower access and egress opening. Many injuries actually occur in a home related to getting in and out of a bathtub and shower. So there are minimum opening requirements for accessing and egressing, getting in and out for an adult with enough room to safely step into and exit the shower area without having to twist and turn through a narrow opening. The shower opening or access and egress opening should be at least 22 inches of clear and unobstructed finished width. The 22 inch finished width is based upon approximately upon the width of an adult shoulder. Shower floors and pans, they're difficult to inspect because you can't see any of it. You can test a shower pan, but that's not a guarantee of any performance there. So we can talk about it, but I think we'll skip. Okay, just one of the things that I do with a plastic shower is I step into it. I think you should step into every bathtub and shower, by the way. So you can feel the floor, the bottom surface of the bathtub, especially in a plastic shower, right? Because they're not typically built very well, plastic showers. And you wanna feel around and make sure that the floor doesn't actually fold in, compress in, that are soft. A lot of them are soft. They're not supported well underneath. And that will have an effect near the outlet, the drain, the strainer. Because if you press in the plastic floor at the strainer, now you're allowing water to possibly leak, not into, drain into the pipe, but leak underneath. So you wanna step into, and that will also have you look at the glazing and the door operation itself, if it's sliding or hinged. And getting in there is a good way to see if hot is on the left or if there are markings, and you check the shower head. So getting in is a pretty good way to test the floor of a shower without testing it with water. Shower liners, they could be flexible membranes, chlorinated polyethylene, sheet lead liners, sheet carpet liners. There's a lot of things that you will never see when you're doing a typical home inspection. Glass doors enclosing the shower should be made of safety glazing, and they're typically labeled for indoor use only. And there are glazing for human impact loads that meet certain requirements, and for also for plastic ones as well, for glass and plastic. If a person slips or falls inside a shower, she or he may be seriously injured by broken glass if the glass is not made by safety glazing. And also that comes to mind of whirlpool tubs and large tubs where there's a surface area where you could sit and also walk around the tub. So I remember inspecting a really nice home that had a large tub and a surface area tiled around, and you can actually walk around. Nobody would, but I did, because the ceiling was cathedral and it's kind of low, and there were windows there, and those windows were not safety windows. So I called it out, because you could actually walk around. So here's the glazing. Windows and doors within the tub area, shower or sauna, require safety glazing. Those areas are specific hazardous locations because the occupant could break the glazing, causing serious injury. Glass wall partitions and windows that enclose the tub and shower areas are also specific hazardous locations that should have safety glazing. A glass door enclosing a tub or shower area should be of safety glazing. An exterior window and an exterior wall must be safety glazing unless the bottom exposed edge of the glass is 60 inches or more above the tub's floor surface. If it's below 60 inches, if the bottom of that window is below 60 inches, that's a problem, right? If it's not safety glazing. Some bathrooms, there's a sitting ledge or other horizontal surfaces around the tub with large glass windows. The ledge may not decrease the hazard potential. Therefore, safety glazing is required. Let's go to automatic clothes washers. I'm gonna check to see if there's questions. Yep, sinks and lavatories require a shutoff. You typically have shutoffs at every fixture. There's a question about the waste drain setup for the disposal in the earlier picture. Does it represent concern for flooding other sinks? Nick, I'll have to go back and take a look at that. With S-traps not being allowed, does that mean pipes must always exit through the wall instead of the floor? No. Nope. So you can have plumbing within a cabinet fixture, including the P-trap, and then there could be a stack right there. There could be other fittings with the drain waste vent system. If you find an S-trap, do you call it out? Yes, I do, typically. But it's not a really big red flag that I yell and scream about. It's fairly an easy fix with a plumber, a pipe adjustment maybe in the cabinet. But if I'm on my game, I'll typically see an S-trap, call it out very quickly. I use a mobile device to write my inspection reports, and there's a narrative about what an S-trap is and why we don't want S-traps anymore. That shows the snap track exposed. Your picture on the left shows a trap exposed. Trap exposed. Sorry, Charles, I must have missed something. Does the washing machine plastic insert for the plumbing supposed to be waterproof? Does the washing machine plastic insert box for the plumbing supposed to be waterproof? The washing machine insert box. Waterproof? You mean this plastic right here? It's typically made out of plastic, and there's the outlet or discharge. So Charles, maybe we can email each other. I've recently viewed a number of plumbing systems that are vented at the kitchen sink location rather than running the vent up through the home, is this the code? Yeah, so venting is part of our next class. This is just about fixtures, but if you take a look at the plumbing course itself, we'll talk about vents and even, again, traps. There are different types of traps that we like to go through. And then the sanitary drainage with the discharge, the drainage, and the venting. Should the shutoff valve be operated during the inspection? No. Not required to operate shutoff valves during the inspection according to InterNACHI standards of practice. There may be something local, some standard that you're using that requires you to do that. What happens when you turn a valve and it starts to leak? Or maybe it's the main water valve and that starts to leak, right? So you don't want to test valves by turning them unless you're required to by some code or authority having jurisdiction over you. So I never do valves, especially fuel valves. Okay, those are the questions. Let's see, clothes washers. An automatic clothes washer protects the potable water supply by having an air gap. So that's that hose with actual airspace. It's not really connected to the drain waste vent system. Or a backflow preventer is installed. The waste from an automatic clothes washer must discharge its wastewater through an air brake into a standpipe or into a laundry tub, not a sump pump. Without an air brake, a blockage in the drain would allow the sewer to back up and enter the washer itself. You don't want that. A washer typically discharges into an individually trapped standpipe or laundry sink or tub. The use of a laundry sink or tub is common. If the standpipe is used, the standpipe and its trap should be at least 2 inches in diameter. You need there's a lot of discharge coming from a clothes washer, about 21 gallons a minute. The clothes washer drain should connect to a fixture branch, horizontal branch, or a drainage stack that should be at least 3 inches in diameter. So we got 3 inches here, right? Stack, 2 inches here, standpipe. If it's less than 3 inches, there might be a problem because the discharge rate for an automatic clothes washer is a lot of gallons per minute. Where the clothes washer discharges into a laundry tub, there's probably no problem because of the size of the tub and the holding capacity of that tub should be big enough for the accumulated discharged water and allow drainage with a slow flow rate in the drainage pipe. When the laundry tub waistline connects to a clothes washer standpipe, the standpipe should be at least 30 inches above the standpipe trap weir. And we know what that is because we've seen this before. It's right there. So 30 inches above that. The outlet of the laundry tub must not be more than 30 inches horizontally away from the standpipe trap. All right. Three more things, and then we'll take a quiz, right? We're going to do laundry tubs and trays, floor drains, not really exciting, and then some stuff about water supply. A laundry tray, why do they call it a laundry tray? It's not really a tray. A laundry tray is essentially a sink used in the laundry room of a house. The material of the tray can be cast iron, stainless steel, ceramic, plastic, soapstone. Laundry trays made out of concrete are not permitted. Why? Because they don't provide a smooth, impervious, sanitary surface, and they tend to crack when they get older. The laundry tray is commonly used to receive the discharge of an automatic clothes washer. The laundry tray should have a waste outlet minimum of 1.5 inches in diameter, a strainer, crossbar to restrict stuff going in it. Here's an inspection image of mine. This is a concrete laundry tub, and it was leaking from the bottom, and the steel legs were rusted on the bottom as well. Floor and trench drains. Floor drains are typically installed as an emergency fixture. That's a fixture, a floor drain, to prevent flooding of a room or space. They should be constructed of cast iron, bronze, copper alloy, aluminum alloy, ABS, stainless steel. Floor drains are usually installed at the discretion of the design professional in areas where standing water is common and may represent a hazard or cause damage to the dwelling. Floor drains must be installed or constructed in such a way that they can be properly cleaned so that the drain will continue to function properly. 2-inch minimum diameter drain outlet for central washing machines of multiple dwellings, it's 3 inches. They must be trapped. Floor drains must be trapped. The actual floor drain body may have an integral trap, which I find with a bell top to be problematic. Floor drains should have strainers. They should be removable. The strainer can be flushed with the floor surface, or there could be a dome grate as well. A couple things about water supplies, since we're talking about fixtures so much. If the pressure from the street is inadequate, a booster can be installed on the water supply to all the fixtures. No big deal. Where the water pressure within a dwelling is greater than 80 psi, a water pressure reducing valve with a strainer should be installed to reduce the pressure in the water distribution pipe system in the house to a maximum of 80 psi static. Water hammer, the velocity of the water flow within the water distribution system should be controlled to reduce the possibility of water hammer, and an arrestor can be installed according to the manufacturer's recommendations. Pipe and pipe fittings at fixtures, valves, faucets, all that used in the house's water supply system must not have lead content really in it, but there is a minimum. Standard says 0.25%. And there's a table here of some minimum size of water supply pipes to fixtures. And there should be a water shutoff valve no more than 30 inches away from the fixture connections. So if you're underneath a sink, you should see water shutoff valves. Underneath a tub or near a tub, near dishwashing machines, clothes washing machines, fixtures should have valves, right? That's why I like to see the plumbing access panel on the opposite side of a bathtub. So the common things would be the bathtub. You want a half inch in diameter pipe, dishwasher, the same thing. The hose bib, half inch minimum. Kitchen sink, same thing. A bidet, you can have a little guy, 3/8 inch diameter. Everything's basically a half inch, you'll see, in the water supply system. And the water supply system, the pipes and fittings for the plumbing fixtures should be installed to prevent backflow. Fixture fittings should provide backflow protection. So let's do a quiz, if you're interested. How's that sound? So take a look at the first question. There should be a space of at least blank in front of the water closet, lavatory, and bidet to any wall, fixture, and door. So what is the answer to that? Anybody? Whoops, sorry, move that. 21 inches, Charles, Victoria says 21 inches, 21 inches, 21, 21, 21, everyone's saying 21 inches, let's mark 21 inches. Closet bolts are often made of blank because they resist corrosion. Plastic, string, how about a really tight rope? Everyone's saying brass. Let's do brass. Thanks, everyone. Mark, Daniel, Brian, Lori, Vincent. The waste from an automatic clothes washer must discharge its water through an blank into a standpipe or into a laundry tub. The waste from an automatic clothes washer must discharge its water through something. A cup? A bowl? Yep. Paul, no, it's not 2 inches. There it is. Air gap, very good. I think, we'll see. We'll see if it's right. A standpipe for an automatic clothes washer is used. If a standpipe for an automatic clothes washer is used, the standpipe and its trap should be at least what in diameter? 4 feet, I think. I don't know, what do you guys think? 2 inches, James says 2 inches. Victoria, Loria says 2 inches. I think it's a trick question, but I'll mark 2 if you guys want. Plastic bathtubs are made with crayon. No, in case of accidental exposure to a plumber's torch. They're made of green materials. Green materials, right? Plastic bathtubs are made of what? plastic bathtubs are made with. I'm looking for answers. Fire resistance, yes. Fire resistant chemicals. Yep, very good. I think, I don't know. I'm just agreeing with everyone else. An exterior window at an exterior wall must be made of safety glazing unless the bottom exposed edge of the glass is blank above the tub floor surface. Oh, tub floor surface or the bathroom floor surface? One is like 60 and one is 70 or something. I don't know. Let's just go for 24 inches, right? 60 inches? Well, everybody is saying 60 inches. Okay. 60 inches or more or 60 inches or less? An exterior wall, an exterior window, an exterior wall must be made of safety glazing unless the bottom exposed edge of the glass is 60 inches or more above the top, right? Are we doing 60 inches or more? Okay, or more, got it. Laundry trays made of paper are no longer permitted because they do not provide a smooth, impervious, sanitary surface. Concrete, everyone's saying concrete. All right, I'll mark concrete, don't yell. The shower opening or access and egress opening should be at least blank of clear and unobstructed finished width. 4 inches, just enough to get my hand in there. The shower opening, yeah? 22, 24, let's see. 22, I remember that. Remember the width of the shoulder something? Or is it 24 inches? If you're measuring me, I'm like 36 inches. 24 inches in circumference. Sounds like something goofy in there. What do you think? Should we do 22 or 24? Let's go 22. I see a majority of 22 for shower openings. If a pump at a whirlpool tub is located more than 2 feet from the access opening, right? So that every whirlpool tub should have an access opening. I think we saw one, I didn't point it out. It was a cold air register, right? To try to fool you. But there should be a door. If the pump motor is more than 2 feet from that opening, a minimum size opening of what should be installed? I think it should be like 6 feet. 18 by 18, okay, everyone's saying 18 by 18. Last question, very good. Blank are best described at short lengths of pipe attached directly to a fixture by means of a flange for connection to other piping or traps. Oh, that is definitely a barrel, for sure. That is the definition of a, what? Slip joint, tailpiece. Slip joint is not one of the tailpiece. Trap arms, standpipes, outlets, barrels, or trap primers. Blank are described, are best described as short lengths of pipe attached directly to a fixture by means of a flange for connection to other pipe. Oh, tailpiece, tailpiece, everyone's doing tailpiece. Rob, everyone's saying tailpiece. Okay, tailpiece. Okay, let's grade the quiz, okay? Grade the quiz. This is a typical quiz of an online, free online course for InterNACHI members. So we're gonna grade the quiz and see what happens. Congratulations, you've answered 100% of the questions correctly. Very good. Round of applause. Well, everybody, I hope you had a fun time learning how to inspect plumbing fixtures. Thank you all for coming. I'll try to get the video up live for everyone else who couldn't make it. And again, I want to leave you with this, nachi.org/articles, where we have a ton of articles. Within that library of articles, there's a thing called, what do you do if you damage something during the inspection? How are you supposed to handle that? Well, doing damage during an inspection is actually your job. So you've got to read that article. It's really, really good. It will change your mind about what you do for people, especially if something happens to break in your hand. So while you're doing a visual home inspection. And the other thing I want to leave you with is my name. I'm Ben Gromicko from InterNACHI. That's the International Association of Certified Home Inspectors. This was How to Inspect Plumbing Fixtures class, free online class that we did here at InterNACHI headquarters. Go to NACHI.org/class if you want to register for the next class or watch any of the past classes because we've recorded them all, or listen to a podcast. And if you want to contact us, we're on the contact page. Bye, everybody. Hope you had fun. I'll see you later. I know I had fun. I'll see you later. Bye.